Welcome. Thanks for joining us. This is the first in what will be a series, a 50th anniversary podcast celebrating the golden anniversary of the birth of Walter State Community College. I'm Rob Pratt. It's a pleasure to be with you today. I have the privilege of serving as the Assistant Dean of Humanities, teaching communication, coaching the debate team, and generally enjoying my life here. And as I say that, I'm looking at someone else here who really enjoys his job as well here, Dr. Tim Holder.
It's a pleasure to be here. I'd like to think that I'm one of the best assistant deans involved in this podcast, at least in the top two. And I'm the Assistant Dean of Behavioral and Social Sciences. This is starting my 17th year at Walter State, and I spent my first 12 years on the Sevier County campus before coming over to Hamblin County, and this semester, I'm actually splitting time between both campuses. I've done some advising in Greenville and Claiborne, so I've got a little bit of a global perspective on what is Walter State, but my perspective is not as global as Rob's.
Well, thank you, Tim. For me, this college was always a part of my life from my earliest memories. It began in a way that you really wouldn't have anticipated someone ever becoming associated with a college. My father, Bob Pratt, was high school baseball teammates with a man named Bill Carlisle, and they played at Morristown High in the 1950s. Dad was a pitcher with a curveball, and Coach Carlisle was a powerful hitting first baseman. They played together then and were lifelong friends. In 1977, when I was five, Coach Carlisle came here to become head basketball coach of the Walter State Senators. He'd been an assistant at Oklahoma State University and had served elsewhere. I was a kindergartner, and Dad said, "I'm going to go see my friend Bill coach these games, and you ought to go with me." It was a father-son time for me to be here and to see 1970s basketball played with the uniforms and hairstyles and style of play that you would associate with that time. So in its first decade in the 1970s, here I was as a young child on this campus. A college was a part of my life when I was in kindergarten. And I found then that the president, Dr. Jack Campbell, all of the coaches and the others who were here at that time were so very welcoming of me, that from my earliest ages, college wasn't something that intimidated me, but it was something that seemed like a home that you could become a part of. I did that later as a student here after seeing all those basketball games in the 1970s and 80s. As a student, entering in the fall of 1990 from Morristown East High School, I came here, had the privilege of serving as the president of the Senators Pages, the official host corps of the college, wearing the red jackets and giving tours on campus, helping students in the registration process. And that would be the beginning of what's now been three decades of on-again, off-again official connection with this college. It's been an honor each time to come here. I went away to do some other things and explore other professional responsibilities, but I came back here from 1999 to 2002 and worked with what was then the Office of Public Information. And then I got a very good view in doing what we now think of as communications and marketing, of how this entire college works. We carried the story of this college, and I got a front row seat again to see how we impact people here with our programs and with our students. Whether they are fresh out of high school or non-traditional students, we told their stories and saw how we impacted them. And then I went away and did some other things again, and had a chance to teach here part-time in the latter part of the first decade of this century. And then 5 years ago, came back here and applied for a job teaching what was then called speech, that we now call communication, teaching students, usually about 100 of them per semester, to do public speaking and to do interpersonal communication with each other. And I've had a chance to coach the debate team here as we compete against some of the best colleges and universities in the region. So as I look back at it here, coming with my dad to see his friend Bill Carlisle coach, who is still the head basketball coach 43 years later.
Wow.
And being on campus as a student in the early 1990s, giving tours, meeting other students who, like me, were beginning their educational process, coming back to work in a public relations and marketing capacity here later, and then teaching part-time, and a few years later coming back here to teach full-time, I really feel like that I have been as much a recipient of what this college has to offer as anything. Now, this will not be about me. This is not the Rob Pratt story. This is your life. But like my friend Tim Holder, I see the richness of what this place can do. And Tim, your work on various campuses reminds us that this college that began in 1970 in Morristown, Tennessee, is a true multi-campus facility now.
Yeah, it's pretty special. You go back 50 years and Walter State as a campus community didn't exist. The classes were being held off-site and they were working on the first building. And we've gone from one building in Hamblin County to multiple buildings, obviously, and then multiple cities. So we went from one location to having four campuses and a presence in a fifth county. And so that that growth has been remarkable. But it is a pretty special thing. After 50 years, we're looking back, and Rob's perspective is so unique as a student and a faculty member and somebody who is in administration. So that's a unique perspective. And then my perspective of being on multiple campuses. So hopefully we can provide a more thorough kind of global look at Walter State through the ages. And as we have subsequent podcasts, our hope is to bring in various individuals from through the years and get some of their stories and get their perspective. It is a pretty special place. And as Rob has already indicated, we really take seriously the community part of the community college. There really is a sense of being on a team, being a part of a family, people who care. It's a pretty special place, and 50 years is a pretty significant milestone. So this is an exciting opportunity for Rob and I.
What's amazing about it, Tim, is that some of these individuals who were here in those earliest days teaching students are still here. And one of them happens to be my boss, Malcolm McAvoy, and we dearly hope to talk with him at some point. He is in his 50th year here. He arrived here in 1971. I believe he will tell us it's the only full-time job he's ever had. And he came here to start the debate team and to teach speech. I think he had to teach half English when he first arrived here because there wasn't enough for a full-time person in communication. Now we have seven of them and at least that many adjuncts this semester. So as with you in behavioral and social sciences, we've seen a growth in our discipline here as our numbers have grown. And when you're talking about serving 6,000 or more students in some years, we feel like we really get a shot at all of them. And that's one thing that's unique about the subjects that we teach. While we have a few majors, I think we're reaching out in that general education requirement to connect with so many students here. And we're mindful of the fact that this college started a nursing program in the 1970s when people thought that was such a challenge for a community college to ever do. This college has been able to raise money and to create facilities in a way that very few others have. I bring up Malcolm McAvoy, my boss, because he says when he took that job, fresh with his graduate degree from the University of Tennessee, community colleges were still the great experiment, and he wondered if they would last. I think Walter State has proven its staying power, and we're starting into the second half century now.
Yeah, that's pretty special. I was reading just earlier today about the start of the experiment in the 1960s. The state decided to commit some money to see if this community college thing would work. They were particularly interested in creating educational opportunities in rural areas where students might feel that the big four-year college was too far away, too intimidating. So kind of the idea was bringing college to the people more. And it's interesting to me that there are so many people here who have Rob's experience of being students at Walter State and then wanting to come back and be part of the faculty. And I think that says something about what a special place Walter State is. And I certainly think it helps our current student body to have so many professors who can put themselves in the shoes of the students because they had that exact perspective of being students at this institution themselves.
That's certainly a good point that you make, Tim. Obviously, this place has impacted lives. And we think about a number of people who came here as I did when they were 18, right out of high school. And for them, it was the beginning of what would lead to a bachelor's degree or beyond. But we're also so satisfied when our classes are populated with students who are older. And when I say older, even having people who are in their mid to late 20s and all the way up, can change the perspective in a classroom. And it's part of that education for our students here. They've been in high school with people their own age. They come here and they see a room full of people who may look a bit different, may come from a different generation, and together they learn. And that's so important in communication class. And I know for you in history, you would see it too. I think my age range here, I taught the youngest student I've ever taught last year. He was 14. He was a dual enrollment junior homeschool. My oldest student thus far was 67, and in her early 70s, she's still hanging around here. And she was a leader in her class in a way that hardly any student ever has been for me. She was auditing the class and made the top score in the class. But as I think about a place to learn, and we stereotypically think about college students, it's not in my mind what we would think of when we watch a movie or read a book about university students. It's a true representation of the community. And age 14 to 67, I think, gives me a pretty strong claim that I've seen it. Now, most will be in their 20s, 30s, and a few are older. But whatever someone's age, they should consider Walter State. They will be made to feel welcome, and they won't be alone here.
Yeah, it's interesting, just that theme of change. When the community college was first started, it was really seen as a place for high school graduates to go. And now, as Rob points out, we do have an increasing percentage of older students being part of our educational experience. And obviously, a more recent change that really for Walter State goes back several years is the emphasis on technology. And when we had to go online last March, that was a lot smoother of a transition for Walter State than it was for other institutions, because Walter State has stressed so much over the last several years, training for professors, professors being able to actually make a little extra money by getting training with online instruction and apps and things like that. And so it's interesting to have this one foot in the past and go back 50 years and talk about where we were as things are changing so much in the present regarding what an education process looks like at Walter State for students and professors. We want to give our students an education in communications and history or nursing or accounting or whatever, but we're all getting an education in technology and how to take a video conference and do Zoom and Teams and whatnot. And so it's an interesting time of change, but as educators, that's something that we should embrace, the opportunity to learn new things and to learn how to do things differently.
We clearly have done that. Tim's right. We've been able to build on some skills that we were exploring as educators through training here, and we've been able to use those in real time. I think our sense was that some of the things we're doing now would be a part of how we delivered education at some point, perhaps in a decade or two. But as with the space race or as with a World War II size event, what we're seeing is an acceleration of the use of technology and an advancement. Walter State is positioned, as Tim said, to be at the forefront. Many schools have and will struggle with some of the transitions that have been made. But I think here it begins with the investment we've made in people and their training, and it's the attitude that people have in embracing it. And our students, you really cannot underestimate our students and their ability. In March, we had no warning this would happen. No one did. And suddenly, we were online. I mean, these buildings were closed for safety for that period of time. Students embraced that and did very well. We had time to plan in the summer, so we learned new tools and new experiences. And I have to think, Tim, that those people who started this school in 1970, or when it opened in 1970, they would never have thought of delivering class this way because the technology didn't exist. But in their imaginations, they would have wanted to believe that Walter State would still be at the forefront in a half century, and it is.
Yeah. So we've got an agenda with these podcasts. We want to be informative. We want to be interesting. We want to introduce our listeners to people who've been a part of the Walter State family. I'm hopeful that we can incorporate a little humor. Maybe Rob and I can brainstorm some goals for ourselves. Like, I think it would be great if we could get someone to sing. Not like maybe someone from the music department, but just whoever we have on here, just invite them to belt out a few lines and see if anyone takes us up on that. So the sky's the limit with what we might do. Hard to say.
Yeah, I'm really excited about seeing where this will go, because in my TV reporter days, I always learned that if you go out and you start talking to people and you start listening to their stories, you can always find something you never dreamed of. They will guide you. And I hope that those who listen to this podcast and to this series will do that. In our community here, we've been pretty good about sharing the narrative of what's going on here, but there's still a lot of stories that people don't know. We have relatively low turnover compared to most places. People stay here for a while, but yet we have gone through decades where people naturally reached retirement age, and we have a lot of new people here over time as well. But I think the common thread through them all is they're a part of that Walter State story, which for me began in the 1970s when I was just a young child and who loved to run around campus and watch basketball and to spend time with my dad. But he always said Walter State is the best thing to happen to this area. And he's not alone in that. You hear that so often. And I think as we look back over these 50 years, Tim, we're going to meet some of the people and hear some of the stories that help illustrate for us how this place has made such an impact. And I really think we're just beginning with that as we begin the second half century in the most unusual time of educational delivery that we have ever confronted.
I'm kind of wondering if maybe we're just about ready to land the plane here. Rob and I hadn't really talked about how to end a podcast, so that'll be interesting. Will one of us make a signal? Will we have a safe word that we use? It's really hard to say.
I don't know, Tim. I'm going to follow your lead on that. You've been hanging around here for a little while and doing a lot of teaching, and also I won or lost the coin flip and had to go first, so I'm going to let you sign this one off today.
Yeah, I think if Rob and I could pull together like just an impromptu theme song, that maybe that would be a good note to walk away with. But I don't know, that might be just slightly exceeding what our talents can bring to the table today. So tune in next time, and maybe Rob and I'll have that theme song for you. But until then, thank you for spending this time with us, and we look forward to the podcast ahead and what we might learn about Walter State and the people that we might have an opportunity to visit with. Thank you for your time. Have a good day.